Namaste. Good evening, and welcome to our continuing series on the Life Divine with our beloved brother, Ranga. We continue with the Supermind as Creator, beginning with the line, thus the whole process of differentiation by the real idea.
Okay. So we read the para first, mm-hmm. and then if needed, we'll come back to it. Maybe it would be a good idea to say what he has said before, then we get the sense of continuity.
Yes.
Okay, so I just read out to you in different words what he has said in the previous para. Supermind is a vast self-extension of the Brahman that contains all and develops all by the idea. We can use our words, the archetype and the blueprint. That's the idea. It develops, expands, extends Satchidananda with a three-in-one reality. Then he says...
Did you start from the...
But no, I'm reading from the summary that I have
from
made.
From your summary.
Yeah.
Okay, good.
In different words.
Mm-hmm.
Supermind brings out, sort of unzips the potential from each of the Sat and Chit and Ananda, which is condensed and it expands into the vastness. It manifests the many, but does not really divide. It is apparent separation, like the sea and the waves, for instance.
Mm.
The sea is divided into waves, but the waves continue to be the sea. There is no difference between the two. Each potential becomes a deity containing all the others, the Vedic gods of the overmind. And this capacity to seemingly divide without separating is the origin and essence of the more pronounced differentiation in the lower creation. Even in the lower creation, differentiation is there, but essential identity is hiding behind the differences, differentiation, which is very obvious in the species. Individualization is there, and yet there is a unity of the species.
I think Mother calls it the genius of the species.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's right.
I remember reading that once.
Yeah.
Very beautiful.
So each species is something, there is a unity, and in the unity there are individuals, whether it be cats or dogs or human beings or whatever. The unity and the differentiation, the individuality is always there. Then he goes on to say, Supermind has the power, which is Maya, to contain, develop, create, and make explicit each principle and form. We may say that the entire creation is a movement between two involutions and also two evolutions. From spirit, all develops downwards, and from inconscient matter, all develops upwards towards spirit. Spirit involves itself in matter, and matter evolves itself back into the spirit.
Mm.
This is what he said in the previous para. So now we continue with what we have to read today. Thus, the whole process of differentiation by the real idea, creative of the universe, is a putting forward of principles, forces, forms, which contain for the comprehending consciousness all the rest of existence within them and front the apprehending consciousness with all the rest of existence implicit behind them. Therefore, all is in each as well as each in all. Therefore, each seed of things implies in itself all the infinity of various possibilities, but is kept to one law of process and result by the will, that is to say, by the knowledge force of the conscious being who is manifesting himself and who, sure of the idea in himself, predetermines by it his own forms and movements. The seed is the truth of its own being, which this self-existence sees in itself. The resultant of that seed of self-vision is the truth of self-action, the natural law of development, formation, and functioning, which follows inevitably upon the self-vision and keeps to the processes involved in the original truth. All nature is simply then the seer will, the knowledge force of the conscious being at work to evolve in force and form all the inevitable truth of the idea into which it has originally thrown itself. So he is constantly referring back to the idea and the real idea.
But he says all nature with a capital N.
Yes, that's right.
It's very important.
Yeah. So it's exactly very, very similar to the process of creation to the seed becoming the tree. The essence is there in the seed and everything is predetermined there. Branches, leaves, fruits, flowers, and each thing that can become manifest in the world is the real idea. Or sometimes he is using the word idea, sometimes he is using the word real idea, because to differentiate between our idea, which can become a reality, may not become a reality, but there it is bound to become a reality. That's why he uses the word real idea.
And he hyphenates it.
Yeah, that's right. So I like to think of it as the blueprint before a house is made. Mm-hmm. The blueprint is essentially what the house will become. At our level, the architect of the builder may not be able to execute his blueprint, but there it is sure to become what it has been visualized. Truth, vision, and then it has also the power to execute what it is doing. So that's what he's saying in the para.
And I have read recently that Mother told a disciple that many new flowers have occurred already through the supermental.
Yes. That is bound to happen. Once the Superman comes down, it represents the infinite. Therefore, there will be infinite.
And Mother said to us that flowers would be the first to change because their life is an aspiration for light.
Yes. Yes.
Before men. You want to go through it once?
Yes, we'll do that.
Be good.
Okay. So, you go sentence by sentence. Thus, the whole process of differentiation by the real idea, creative of the universe, is a putting forward of principles, forces, forms, which contain for the comprehending consciousness all the rest of existence within them and front the apprehending consciousness with all the rest of existence implicit behind them. So, we have already discussed what is the comprehending consciousness and the apprehending consciousness. The consciousness that contains the whole is the comprehending consciousness. And the apprehending consciousness is the divine presence which goes into each thing separately. That's the apprehending consciousness. It apprehends each thing separately. So, in fact, we know that the divine takes three basic forms. The transcendent, outside the universe. In the universe, the cosmic aspect, which often is represented as pantheism. The divine is there everywhere in nature. And he is also there in the individual. And individual doesn't mean only the human being. It is there in everything, right down to the atom. In each atom, the divine presence is there. That's the immanent, you call it, transcendent, cosmic, and the immanent, the personal.
Can you speak a little bit about pantheism?
Not that I know much, but the pantheists see God as nature. Mm-hmm. And when they see God as nature, they don't see Him as transcendent or the individual. Nature itself is God. They see it in that way. So that's pantheism. And those who are the Advaitins and the Mayavadins and the Buddhists, they think of the divine as impersonal, transcendent. And the Bhakta thinks that the divine is within each one. But each one thinks his experience is so satisfying that they don't want to admit very easily the others. They feel that this is the final. Here is Sri Aurobindo who comes and says that all of them are right partially. But if you have the knowledge of all the three, then you know the divine fully. Mother says something about, when can you know the divine fully? She says, if you can know the whole universe entirely at the same time.
Exactly. Yes, yes.
Then you can know the divine. Otherwise you can't. You look at only a part of him. Fantastic. So, this is what he says, that the whole process of differentiation. Also, we must keep in mind, manifestation means the one becoming the many. But this many is not a real many, but a phenomenal many. It's an appearance many. In appearance, it is the many. Behind the many, there is always the unity lurking behind, hiding behind. And as you keep going up in consciousness, the multiplicity starts reducing and the unity starts increasing. At the level of the higher mind itself, you start seeing the oneness of things, and the multiplicity sometimes seems to be an illusion. You make your mind silent, go to the self or the Brahmic consciousness, your mind is absolutely calm and quiet, you have the cosmic consciousness, you see the physical world as unreal, only images. So that is also very convincing to them. But there are others who say they can go even more. Each, he has dealt with that. Those who are the transcendent, that's the Advaita philosophy. Seeing the divine in nature is the pantheism. And when you see the individual in yourself, that's the bhakti path, the Vaishnava philosophy. Okay, we go to the next one. Apprehending. So, apprehending consciousness, comprehending consciousness is both there. The divine includes everything and also is included in everything. And that's why you have this fantastic phrase, therefore, all is in each as well as each in all. The infinite and the finite are completely plunged into each other. My famous four lines from Blake. We go back to that, okay? Mm. Because it's very, very apt what he says. No? He says, to see a world in a grain of sand and heaven in a wildflower, hold infinity in the palm of your hand and eternity in an hour. So this is what Perfect. Is exactly what Shraddha is saying. They are complete. And that is also the reason why man contains in himself in seed form the entire universe. The universe is the expanded Brahman, the individual is the contracted Brahman, if you want. It's the same. And that's the reason why if you go into yourself, you can get the cosmic consciousness. If you are not the cosmos in essence, you can't have the cosmic consciousness, but you are. One is the, another way of understanding this again is, a grain of salt, it's got a clear form and it's got a clear taste and character. Throw that into water, the form disappears. But the essence of the salt remains everywhere. That's the difference between the individual and the cosmic. You can see it also in that way. Yes. The essential individuality does not disappear. The salt is there everywhere, but there is no form now anymore. So that's the individual and the universal. Hmm. We come back to our... Therefore, every seed of things implies in itself all the infinity of various possibilities, but it is kept to one law of process and result by the will, the divine will. That is to say, by the knowledge force of the conscious being who is manifesting himself and who, sure of the idea in himself, predetermines by it his own forms and movements. This, what he is saying here, is there very much in the physical world. Each cell of the body contains the whole in its RNA and DNA. If you know that, you can rebuild the whole. So each thing that is there corresponding, the color of your hair, the color of your eyes, the color of your skin, the shape of your nose, everything is there contained in this RNA and DNA. So the infinite, the finite, contains the whole. That's exactly what he's saying here also. See carefully. He's saying, therefore, every seed of things implies in itself all the infinity of various possibilities, but is kept to one law of process and result by the will. That is to say, by the knowledge force of the conscious being who is manifesting himself and who, sure of the idea in himself, predetermines by its own forms and movements. In other words, each thing contains the whole, but each thing is putting everything else in the background and developing only one aspect. That's What
this,
is it?
This can be applied to the various parts of yoga, like bhakti yoga and jnana yoga, like each is one line of movement.
That's right.
It contains the
You can say that. In fact, all the real ideas are there, and each real idea is, at the highest level, the real idea is really one. But then it starts becoming the many, and each one is manifesting according to the plan intended and visioned above. It comes down and becomes exactly what it is.
So again, the seed of the pine tree cannot become an oak.
No, that's right. That's exactly what he's saying.
Yes.
Because although it contains the whole, it goes along one line. Yeah. There's another way of looking at it also, I think. What you can say is, essentially, let's take the elements, okay? They're essentially one, but each one, depending on the number of electrons there, becomes either hydrogen or oxygen or uranium or gold or silver. But it contains the whole. That can be changed. But there is a stress on one aspect of the divine. In fact, one becomes the various, the one again becomes the multiplicity. The same idea. The one contains all these things, but when it is developing itself, it concentrates only on one aspect and the individual.
So I would like to ask you about the scientists' work on DNA and stem cell research.
Yes, that's right.
What is happening there?
So, I'm not a biologist, but what I understand of the stem cell is, the stem cell is that which has come away from the oneness and contains the potential for becoming anything. So it is somewhere in between the one and the multiplicity. It, the one also contains, but essentially. But the stem cell is such that if you put it in contact with bone, it will become bone. If you put it in contact with skin tissue, it will become skin tissue. It has the potential to go into any direction. But once it starts its journey, it will complete the journey and become only skin or bone or
even in
light sensitive retina.
Yes, yes.
Hair. It can become anything. So, but there is a moral problem with stem cell. Because I think when you do that, you are destroying a life. Something like that is there. I'm not sure. But there is some such
thing. Now I hear that they're taking it from the umbilical cord.
Acha. So
and
then.
So that's not damaging anything.
So
it used to be from the stillborn child.
Ah.
But now it's from the umbilical cord.
So again, we have the same idea.
Yes.
So everything that is there in the higher, it is, Sri Aurobindo says very clearly that everything in the world is symbolic of the higher spiritual truths. You can see that also here.
Yes.
The same. So, the image of the seed and the tree is always very, very useful. So therefore, each seed of things implies in itself all the infinity of various possibilities, but is kept to one law of process and result by the will, and that is to say, by the knowledge force of the conscious being, who is manifesting himself and who, sure of the idea in himself, predetermines by it his own forms and movements. By the way, this is very much related also to the question of knowledge and ignorance, because when the consciousness comes down, the one becoming the many, each of the many, you, me and all, we have the whole knowledge, but we have concentrated only on one aspect. And all the rest of it is kept in the background. And that is, he defines ignorance in that way. He says ignorance is nothing but the putting away of all that you know into the background and concentrating only on one aspect. So, ignorance is nothing but a process of knowledge. Knowledge has the power to concentrate on one aspect, forgetting all the rest. Exactly like if you are reading here, all our attention is on the life divine. We have forgotten that my address is in 28 Dupuy Street. I have also forgotten that I have a sister in. All this information is there, but kept in the background, I am concentrating only on this one. That is ignorance. At our level, we can easily recover that we have put into the background. But there it is more fundamental. It's more difficult to get back what we have lost. You need the process of yoga for that. At our level, only memory will do. But at that level, you have got to get back what you have put away purposely into the background. He defined, that's very much related to what he is saying here. Okay. The seed is the truth of its own being, which this self-existence sees in itself. The resultant of that seed of self-vision is the truth of self-action. The natural law of development, formation and functioning, which follows inevitably upon the self-vision and keeps to the processes involved in the original truth. All nature is simply then the seer will, the knowledge force of the conscious being at work to evolve in force and form all the inevitable truth of the idea into which it has originally thrown itself. Again, the idea of the blueprint and the becoming the reality. So everything that is intended, it has the power to, it has not got only the power to imagine, it has also got the power to execute and complete the process. That's what he's saying. We don't have that power. We may have part of it, but we don't have that power.
So there must be an evolution into the supermanhood.
Yes. In fact, evolution continues even beyond the supermind. Yes.
Yes.
It goes on. There's no end to it. Okay? Then. We read the next one. This conception of the idea points us to the essential contrast between our mental consciousness and the truth consciousness. We regard thought as a thing separate from existence, abstract, unsubstantial, different from reality, something which appears one knows not whence and detaches itself from objective reality in order to observe, understand, and judge it. For so it seems and therefore is to our all-dividing, all-analyzing mentality. The first business of mind, MCAP, is to render discrete, to make fissures, much more than to discern. And so it has made this paralyzing fissure between thought and reality. But in supermind, all being is consciousness. All consciousness is a being. And the idea, a pregnant vibration of consciousness, is equally a vibration of being pregnant of itself. It is an initial coming out in creative self-knowledge of that which lay concentrated in uncreative self-awareness. It comes out as idea, that's a reality, that is a reality, and it is that reality of the idea which evolves itself, always by its own power and consciousness of itself, always self-conscious, always self-developing by the will inherent in the idea, always self-realizing by the knowledge ingrained in its every impulsion. This is the truth of all creation, of all evolution. What he seems to be saying here is that Sat, Chit, Shakti, Ananda are all one. The consciousness which is visualizing what it wants to do, it also has the power to do what it wants to do. Therefore, there is a perfect execution of the idea. If that was not there, like in our case, that's what he's saying. Difference between our mental consciousness and the supermental being. I'll read out the same thing in different words. Maybe it will help. Okay? So, we can now, what he's saying in this para, we can now see the difference between our mind and the supermind. Our mental consciousness and the gnosis, truth consciousness. And the difference is this. Our conception is that the universe and our thinking are two separate things. Our mind detaches itself from the reality of the world and observes it, judges it, tries to understand it. This is the nature of the all-dividing, all-analyzing mentality. Thought and reality are two separate entities to man. But to the supermind, all these are one and the same. Consciousness is Sat, which is substance. And substance, existence, is a is conscious of itself. And each real idea is a seed vibration of a physical, subtle reality to be, to exist, to want to exist in the manifestation. The real idea is conscious and molds its own substance into what it intends to become and consummates itself. This is what evolution really is. This is what he's saying. The real idea is conscious of itself. It has also the power to execute itself and become what it wants to do. At our level, it's not like that. There is a difference.
Can we see any of it in the world at work?
Pardon?
Can we see any of the real idea now at work in the world?
I think each real idea is trying to realize itself. So, in fact, everything in the universe corresponds to a real idea in the higher planes of consciousness. In fact, you could use the word archetype for that.
Ah.
The archetype of everything in the physical world is a real idea, you could say in that way. So it becomes a reality here. Here is a distorted form, but the ideal form of whatever you see in the physical world is there.
So falsehood is an archetype of truth?
Pardon?
Falsehood is an archetype of truth?
No, truth is the archetype
truth
of...
Truth is the archetype yeah, of falsehood.
Rather, put it this way, truth is the archetype, divine truth is the archetype of truth here at our level, and falsehood is a distortion of that idea. Because in the physical world we have dualities. Remember, one becoming the many infinitely creates dualities. So, falsehood is something which seems to be the opposite in the world of multiplicity and dualities. You can't say that truth is the archetype of falsehood. I don't think you can say that. But truth becomes truth and falsehood here in the physical world. That truth with the T cap becomes the truth with the lowercase. Yeah, that's right. So, then Srimad is continuing about the supermind. In supermind, being, consciousness of knowledge and consciousness of will are not divided as they seem to be in our mental operations. They are a trinity, one movement with three effective aspects. Each has its own effect. Being gives the effect of substance, consciousness the effect of knowledge, of the self-guiding and shaping idea of comprehension and apprehension. Will gives the effect of self-fulfilling force. But the idea is only the light of the reality illumining itself. It is not mental thought nor imagination, but effective awareness, self-awareness. It is real idea. So he is contrasting, now it becomes very simple because he is contrasting the two. In supermind, being, when he uses the word being, he means a substance. He sometimes uses the word existence, sometimes uses the word substance. And you use the word sat. Sat in Sanskrit can be interpreted as truth also. Because in many ways it can be interpreted as truth. But what is truth? In the physical world, what is the most obviously the thing that exists and is true? Matter. And matter is substance which has become gross. But as you keep going higher and higher, this substance becomes very, 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 very subtle, very, very subtle. And that is the substance with which the whole entire universe is created. That is Sat. So when he uses the word being or existence, he means always the same thing. Subtle substance at the highest level. We don't think of these things, even our thoughts have substance. Even our emotions have substance, form, color, shape, everything. But we don't think of it in that way. There is substance right up to the divine. He is also using this subtle substance to create the universe. In the Sankhya philosophy, it's called the pradhana. That which is the infinite subtlest of substance used to create the universe of the gross forms. So, in supermind, being, consciousness of knowledge and consciousness of will. So, consciousness of knowledge is chit and consciousness of will is Shakti. Consciousness and force, they always go together. At the highest level, they are together. At the lower level, consciousness does not necessarily imply force, but consciousness can be force. But force, we normally see it as not conscious. The river is flowing, force, but we don't see any consciousness in it. The wind is blowing, but we don't see any consciousness in it. The tides are coming in, we don't see any consciousness, but it is there. In the force, there is consciousness, and in consciousness also there is force. When you concentrate, you are using consciousness to create something. So both are implied with each other. You can use the words also Purusha Prakriti. Purusha is consciousness, force is Prakriti. They are always together. In this plane, they seem to be inversely proportional to each other. In matter, force is all powerful. Consciousness is sleeping. When you make your mind silent and go to the self in the center, in the middle of the range of existence, consciousness becomes full immutability, no movement at all. These two seem to be opposite to each other, but at the highest level, third level, they become equal to each other. So, in matter, the lowest form, that you have the words, in Gita you have the words, kshara, akshara and the purushottama. So, the kshara is the mutable. The world is mutable. In the mutability, consciousness seems to be sleeping. Force is very apparent. At the atomic level, you can see force is constant. Make your mind silent, consciousness becomes all-powerful. Immutability results, force is held back. At the highest level, both are there together. Mutable, immutable, and the highest, the Shraddha used the word, Ishvara consciousness, the supermind. Okay, so that's what he's saying here. In supermind, being which is existence or substance, consciousness of knowledge and consciousness of will, chit and shakti, are not divided as they seem to be in our mental operations. Our consciousness and force, we seem to have two different things. Okay, but there it is one. They are a trinity, one movement with three effective aspects. Each has its own effect. Being gives the effect of substance. There you are. Okay. Mm-hmm. So being becomes substance. Consciousness, the effect of knowledge, of the self-guiding and shaping idea, of comprehension and apprehension. Will gives the effect of self-fulfilling force. So in Western philosophy, they use the word will more than shakti. In our Indian philosophy, we use the word shakti, force. But there it is will. Consciousness, that is will. And will, shakti and chit are same. In Western philosophy, they use the word will, force. Okay. Each has his own effect, we read that. But the idea is only the light of the reality illumining itself. The reality has a light which is illumining itself. But the idea is only the light of the reality illumining itself. It is not mental thought nor imagination, but effective self-awareness. The word effective means it has the power to become real, effective. It is consciousness that has got the power to realize itself. It is a real idea. This is what it is.
So here he defines real idea.
Yeah. This is real idea. The consciousness which has got the power to effectuate what it is visualizing. In supermind, knowledge in the idea is not divorced from will in the idea, but one with it, just as it is not different from being or substance, but is one with the being, luminous power of the substance. As the power of burning light is not different from the substance of the fire, so the power of the idea is not different from the substance of the being, which works itself out in the idea and its development. In our mentality, all are different. We have an idea and a will. According to the idea or an impulsion of will and an idea detaching itself from it, but we differentiate effectually the idea from the will and both from ourselves. I am, the idea is a mysterious abstraction that appears in me. The will is another mystery, a force nearer to concreteness, though not concrete, but always something that is not myself, something that I have or get or am seized with, but I am not. I make a gulf also between my will, its means and the effect, for these I regard as concrete realities outside and other than myself. Therefore, neither myself nor the idea nor the will in me are self-effective. The idea may fall away from me, the will may fail, the means may be lacking. I myself, by any or all of these lacunae, may remain unfulfilled. Remember, Sri Ramana is saying, may remain unfulfilled. Many of our ideas we can execute in the physical world and become the reality, but not necessarily so at our level. I may want to be an engineer. In 5 years' time, I can become an engineer if I have sufficient concentration. My idea can become a reality. May not. I may run out of money. I may change my idea. So many things may happen. But in the supermind, that doesn't happen. That which is the idea and the force in it, it remains exactly what it is and realizes itself. When he's making a distinction between our mind and there, it becomes very clear what he's saying. Substance, consciousness that is knowledge, will that is force, are all same. Even Ananda is the same. So this is what he's saying. So he has contrasted the supermind from our normal mind. But in the supermind, there is no such paralyzing division, because knowledge is not self-divided, force is not self-divided, being is not self-divided as in the mind. They are neither broken in themselves nor divorced from each other. For the supermind is a vast, it starts from unity, not division. It is primarily comprehensive. Differentiation is only a secondary act. Therefore, whatever be the truth of being expressed, the idea corresponds to it exactly. The will force to the idea. Force being only power of the consciousness and the result to the will. Nor does the idea clash with other ideas, the will or force with other will or force as in man and his world. For there is one vast consciousness which contains and relates all ideas in itself as its own ideas. One vast will which contains and relates all energies in itself as its own energies. It holds back this, advances that other, but according to its own preconceiving idea will. And he's saying that all the ideas that are there don't clash with each other. It's exactly like the orchestra. He uses the image of the orchestra. Each 100 instruments, all playing different things, yet there's a perfect harmony. So different ideas there don't clash. They are complementary aspects of the reality. At our level, it's not like that. One idea can clash with another idea, in fact, bound to clash. He gives very interesting examples of both being true, but they are clashing on freedom and discipline. One example he gives. Freedom and discipline are opposites. Discipline is very necessary. Freedom also is very necessary. But they are opposite to each other. Both are true and yet they clash at our level. There they wouldn't clash. They would become complementary aspects. Another example he gives also in the synthesis, love, compassion and justice. Justice demands that there should be punishment as well as mercy. Okay? Reward and punishment. But compassion doesn't admit punishment. The case of a judge, for instance, the judge is there and he has to implement justice. His son comes to him as a criminal. What is he going to apply, justice or compassion. There is a clash in his mind. Then another idea also is the one and the many, the individual and society. This also is another thing, that the society is more important or the individual is more important. So these are all the ideas that clash at our level, but in the supermind, although each one is each, they don't clash. They are like the orchestra, they have perfect harmony. This happens because of the dualities and the multiplicity in the world. That's what he's saying here. There, it holds back the, he's saying, and the result, nor does the idea clash with other ideas in the supermind. The will or force with each, will or force as in man and his world. For there is one vast consciousness which contains and relates all ideas in itself as its own ideas. One vast will which contains and relates all energies in itself as its own energies. It holds back this, advances that other, but according to its own preconceiving idea will. There is no discord there in the supermind. And all this knowledge, he realized himself also later on, but before that, he was given much of this knowledge by Vivekananda in jail. When he was in jail, Vivekananda came to him in a subtle body and gave him this knowledge.
Ah, so this, how many years does it predate the completion of Savitri?
Just imagine, 1910, he came to Pondicherry.
40 years.
So, more than that even, because he was in jail, I'm not very sure of dates, 1908 or something like that, he was there. And then he knew, and that is the reason why when they achieved the overmind, mother was quite enthused. Mm-hmm. And when she went to him, you know the story.
Yes.
But he poured a little cold water on her and said that this is not what we want. We want the supermind. He knew that theoretically, and that's why he withdrew and put all his energies into the action. That's why he withdrew from others, because he doesn't want diversion and disturbances to his concentration. He completely separated himself and started this work of pulling down the supermind.
But he still answered thousands of letters.
Yes, that he was doing without the physical contact.
Ah, okay.
Without the physical contact.
So that was the vibration that he didn't want.
Yeah. Because that is something that happens when people are there, your thoughts are coming into me, my thoughts are coming into everybody else. There's a constant mixture. We are a marketplace, mother says. So to avoid that and get the pure concentration, he withdrew himself physically. He was seeing nobody after 1938, but 1938 that big accident happened to his leg and there had to be many people in the room. Then the evening talk started.
Yes.
Okay, let's read the last para. This is the justification of the current religious notions of omnipresence, omniscience, and omnipotence of the divine being. Far from being an irrational imagination, they are perfectly rational and in no way contradict either the logic of a comprehensive philosophy or the indications of observation and experience. The error is to make an unbridgeable gulf between God and man, Brahman and the world, which the Mayavadins make. That error elevates an actual and practical differentiation in being, consciousness and force into an essential division. Making the essential division is the falsehood. But this aspect of the question we shall touch upon afterwards. At present, we have arrived at an affirmation and some conception of the divine and creative supermind in which all is one in being, consciousness, will and delight, yet with an infinite capacity of differentiation that deploys but does not destroy the unity, in which truth is the substance and truth rises in the idea and truth comes out in the form, and there is one truth of knowledge and will, one truth of self-fulfillment and therefore of self-delight. For all self-fulfillment is satisfaction of being. Therefore, always, in all mutations and combinations, a self-existent and inalienable harmony. The last is a non-sentence. There is no verb. Therefore, always, in all mutations and combinations, there exists implied a self-existent and inherent harmony. So Sri Aurobindo often uses these non-sentences, but it's very, very clear what he's saying. Grammatically, wrong, but spiritually right. So that completes this chapter on Supermind as a creator. So now we have a very clear idea. The Satchidananda is the unmanifest. When it wants to manifest itself, it has to necessarily do that by going through the prism, if you want, of Supermind. It's exactly like white light. When it strikes the prism, it breaks up into seven colors. So exactly in the same way, Satchidananda, which is one, goes through the prism of Supermind and makes the multiplicity of the physical world. You can see it in that way. So Supermind is essential for the breakup and the multiplicity, the manifestation of this Satchidananda. So you have three levels. You have the one, which is Satchidananda, then you have the Supermind, which with its power of Maya creates a world, and you have the physical world, the mutable, the immutable, and the Supermind, and above the Supermind you have the Satchidananda unmanifest. This is what he is saying. The next chapter is that this is a truth consciousness. So that truth consciousness, he will explain what it is, and the last one, he will explain to you how the Supermind works. What's the process of Supermind? The triple status of the Supermind. The one that seems to divide itself into several and makes the three levels of Supermind. That's the next chapter.
But he often mentions in Book 11 of Savitri, truth must set its feet on earth.
Yes.
Truth must be this, truth must be that.
Yes.
The truth he's speaking about is above Supermind?
No.
No.
No. It is the Supermind itself.
It is the Supermind.
Yeah.
And is it synonymous with the word Supermind?
Well, truth is one aspect of Supermind. Truth, Sat is truth. Chit, consciousness is there. Force is there as well as Ananda.
Okay.
So when he says truth, he includes probably everything. So our substance must become capable of housing the divine consciousness. So that substance also must become, matter must become, gross matter must become subtle matter in order to house the divine. So that's what probably he means. But it has to become truth here. But everything will not become truth, only a selection will be there. Just like when man has come, the animals continue to remain. When the Superman comes, it will be a different race and man also will exist. Nothing will disappear. Only a part of the world will become Superman. To indicate that even matter can become to this extent divine. And after the Supermind, supermental race, the evolution will continue, but from knowledge to further knowledge, not from ignorance to knowledge. There is no end to evolution. In fact, the Orville Charter contains endless research. The Charter of Orville?
For an evolving humanity,
yes.
I think it is, yes.
Endless research.
Yes.
It will go on and on and on. Okay,
thank you.
Stop here.